finally we get to Spider-Man 2, or to give the more accurate title, Two Spider-Mans, because this time we get to switch between playing as Peter Parker and Miles Morales and can appreciate the stark contrast between the two. Peter is an awkward nerd with superpowers who struggles with balancing his personal life and his desire to fight crime while dressed like an extreme sports techno gimp, whereas Miles is an awkward nerd with superpowers who struggles with balancing his personal life and his desire to fight crime while dressed like an extreme sports techno gimp and is black. I jest, of course. There's also the fact that Peter continues to resemble a buff dude from the neck down and a 12-year-old with an inexpensive barber from the neck up, and while he takes pains to hide his secret identity from those close to him, Miles basically blabs it to anyone he goes on a second Tinder date with. Not that it matters that much, since all the established villains seem to have gone straight at the outset of Two Spider-Mans, but trouble arises when Kraven the Hunter shows up with an army of fanatics and basically occupies the city to mount a campaign of springing supervillains and challenging them to fights to the death. Serious question, does New York City even have a police force? I remember them showing up once or twice at the ends of missions to arrest people, so I assume they're all waiting around the corner going, give it 10 minutes, Spider-Man hasn't had a personal epiphany yet. I just wonder why no one in authority is opposing Kraven at all. Hell, the flippin' TSA should have raised the alarm as he was coming through customs. Anything to declare besides the international terrorist militia, fleet of invisible attack planes, and pack of robot wolves? Silly question to ask in superhero storytelling, I know. Might as well ask why there's no OSHA compliance, preventing the inevitable burning building or exploding roller coaster at precisely the moment where it would be very humiliating for Peter or Miles to have to declare a sudden diarrhea emergency and run off. Now, Spider-Man 1 being a perfectly decent, if somewhat cluttered, game, Spider-Man Part 2 was in the awkward position of having very little to improve upon and an awful lot of things it could fudge up. I really thought I was going to hate the new wingsuit. In theory, anything that takes away from the web-swinging in Spider-Man game traversal is like focusing on the complimentary sausage rolls at an artisanal bacon festival, but thankfully it never replaces web-swinging, merely gives you an option when you run out of buildings besides taking a great big mouthful of pavement panini. And there's still enough skill involved to make it interesting, so that's fine. In fact, it's mostly fine. Let's skip to the end for a moment. Let me summarise my broad feelings about Spider-Man with an anecdote. I had Saturday afternoon off and I was trying to figure out what I wanted to play. You know how a sitcom wife can look at a pile of clothes the exact shape and proportions of a dead humpback whale and announce they haven't got a thing to wear? That's me with my video game collection. But I eventually concluded that I wanted to play more Spider-Man 2. I wanted to spend a few hours swinging about the city, punching crime in the teeth. Spider-Man 2 is therefore officially a game I wanted to play when I had no obligation to do so. Let that be the thing you take away after I'm finished spending the next three paragraphs picking at it like it's a stubborn price sticker on a new piece of expensive electronics. As I said, after Spider-Man 1, there were many ways they could have f***ed it up. One failure, for example, would have been to not remove the bits where you have to play as Mary Jane in mandatory stealth sections, and that opportunity whizzed straight past Spider-Man 2 like a short-sighted territorial magpie. Oh, they give Mary Jane an instant takedown stun gun this time, but that just made me wonder why the hell the Spider-Mans have to punch a dude 15 times to get the same result. It's nothing personal, Mary Jane, it's just, have you noticed the title of the game you're in? If I play a game called Sergeant Flashy Bollocks, it's because I want to spend time only in the company of the most luminescent of testicles. Stop insisting on getting presents when it isn't your birthday party. In fact, all my red marks and see me notes relate to the story campaign. Mary Jane is far from the worst of it when it comes to taking away from the superhero action. Have you ever wanted to play Peter Parker in normal human mode, bumming around the house picking up litter for 10 minutes, or bumming around a theme park and getting on a teacups ride where he can, and hold on to your adult diapers because this might well cause a containment breach, press a button to put his hands up for a second? Wow, why did I ever think dive bombing off the Empire State Building was the pinnacle of excitement? This is becoming typical of Sony exclusives. If it's not God of War making us watch Kratos and pals sullenly eating breakfast together, occasionally pressing X to pass the butter, it's epic superhero tidying your bedroom action. Even in the superhero battles, Spider-Man's tights show the trademark laddering of having been stretched out unnecessarily long. There are multiple boss fights where you get their entire health bar down, there's a brief cutscene of the boss going, oh boy, now I'm really mad, all their health comes back and you just fight them again in exactly the same way, maybe with one new attack if you're lucky. I wonder if this is because, since virtually every Spider-Man villain has a personal connection to Spider-Man, boss fights also have to be these prolonged one-on-one therapy sessions where the characters scream out apologies and in treatments to remember their true selves in between mule kicks to the teeth. Are you complaining about the story of a superhero comic game being like a superhero comic again, Yards? Oh, piss off. You know what? I'm gonna be a superhero fan for a second. Look at me, I like people in capes hitting each other and choke out clouds of offended Cheeto dust whenever a black person gets cast as an established white character in a film. I'm really invested in iconic supervillains now, and I'm annoyed by the way Spider-Man 2 does them dirty. Spoiler warning till end of video, before you all redirect your Cheeto clouds in my direction. Remember Vulture, Electro, and Shocker? Remember the unique character designs and boss fights from the first game that a lot of people probably worked very hard on? Well, they all died off screen. Slow down, Insomniac Games, you're wasting iconic villains faster than the 90s Batman films. Sandman, the Lizard, and Mysterio all show up for the first time in this canon, but are all reformed. So they must have had their origin stories, got beaten up by Spider-Man, and had major character growth off screen. And I'm like, Spider-Man alive, Spider-Man 2, you made me clean up Peter Parker's discarded Chinese takeout, but you couldn't make time for any of that. Oh, and this series is really edging the Green Goblin, isn't it? This is two games they've been setting him up, but at this point, I don't see how he could possibly represent a raising of the stakes. They can't even play up the personal connection to Spider-Man, because whoops, that's every villain. I'm mean, he doesn't have robot tentacles or is a literal alien invasion. He's just a buff dude who surfs, like he was bitten by a radioactive Australian.